Well, thank you for joining us this afternoon on this historic day in West Virginia. This is day 34 of the West Virginia Legislature, and today you have before you the Republican-led Senate and House preparing to release a budget framework that identifies the bold, aggressive, conservative leadership that this state not only wants, but needs, deserves, and will put the path, place in on the path to progress and prosperity for West Virginia. This budget for too long has been controlled by those who want to raise taxes rather than those who want to control spending. This is the moment in time, this historic moment in West Virginia, this early in the session in which we finally release the budget framework that no other legislature has done prior to this point, this early in the process. This is a different plan. This is a plan that not only controls spending, but as I said, the focus is on jobs and opportunity for West Virginia. This is a unique and novel, conservative, responsible approach to budgeting in which we do what every family in West Virginia must do every year. Spend, the fundamental principle is spend no more than you have. That is the most easily discernible takeaway message from this press conference, is that you spend no more than you have. And so the people of West Virginia have been presented with this governor a revenue estimate of $4.055 billion. We will spend in the most compassionate, responsible manner possible that amount of money to the agencies and entities of West Virginia to provide the needed and necessary government services within the budget that we have been presented, without $300 million of new taxes upon the people of West Virginia that are among the poorest in the nation. We have today prepared, if you may, for the state of West Virginia, a check from the taxpayers to the agencies and entities of West Virginia for $4.055 billion. This is what the people want, this is what the people need, and this is like every family must do. Balance your budget with what you have. That's what we do. These are difficult decisions, and it's fallen to the legislature to take the responsible action to prepare that budget. And we are in a position to do so. We will provide you with the details as we move through the press conference today, but I want to show you the alternative that's been proposed. The other check, if you may, spends $4.5 billion against a revenue estimate of 4.055, $450 million in deficits. Like every family in West Virginia, you can't write that check. You can't simply write that check and cash it. It's insufficient funds. We don't have the money. This state, to put it on the path of progress, prosperity, and responsible budgeting, finally to resolve these annual budget crises, must live within our means. That is the message that this Republican-led legislature is delivering to the people of West Virginia. We will finally live within the means that the people of West Virginia, the taxpayers, the citizens of West Virginia have provided this state in terms of revenue. Like every family, we must live within our means. I'd like to call upon my great friend, the Speaker of the House, to provide some additional detail, and we'll be happy to take some questions. Speaker Armstead.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. President. The President just said that it's a novel concept in budgeting in West Virginia to simply spend what you have. And that's a sad commentary on where we've been over the years, because every single family that I know and you know does just that. When they do their household budgets, they spend what they have. They don't go out and say, I would love to spend more. This would be a great idea to do this or that. I think I'll just spend it. If they do, they wind up right here where with insufficient funds. We can't follow that course in West Virginia. We really have to recognize that it should not be a novel thing to live within our means. And there are three very important reasons why I think we have to take the step we're taking today, which is to stay within a $4.055 billion budget number. First of all, that's the number that the governor has given us that he believes is as revenue estimates under the Constitution we will collect. And when we talk about that number, one of the first reasons that we have to stay within that number is because spending $4.5 billion with the idea that somehow that's going to create jobs and prosperity has already been debunked time and time and time again. The idea that if we just spend more in government, that somehow that's going to make us prosperous is not true. It simply isn't true. It has never been backed up with facts or the history of our state. And now we're talking about a proposal that would spend the greatest amount this state has ever spent in general revenue funds, funded by the greatest tax increase in the history of our state. That is not the answer. That's not the right direction to go. And it's never historically, in the history of this state or any other state, that has not been the path to prosperity. So it simply doesn't work, first of all. Secondly, the people of West Virginia can't afford it. They simply can't. As Mitch has said, people are struggling, and we understand that. The downturn in our economy, basically, primarily because of the war on coal that's been waged in our state against our state year after year, has really come home to roost in so many ways, and has caused so much pain to the citizens of West Virginia. And now we're seeing that result showing up in our budgetary process in West Virginia. The people of West Virginia can't afford to have more money taken out of their paychecks. They're trying to decide how to spend this money day after day, what little they have, and we need to give them hope. Rather than saying to them, well, we're sorry, we're going to take more of that, so that government continues to spend more and more, we need to say to them, no. We are drawing the line here. We are saying we understand what you're dealing with each and every day. And if you have to make those tough decisions, you have a right to expect your government is going to have to do the same thing and make those tough decisions. Finally, the third reason I'll say is because this is what we committed to the people of West Virginia. We committed this, that we would downsize, that we would right-size our government, and that we would control spending. We committed to that. The governor committed to that. We're keeping our commitment with this budget. We are keeping the commitment we made as a legislature to the people of West Virginia, because we recognize that spending $450 million more is not the right course to go on. It's not the right direction. It is not sustainable by the people of West Virginia, and it's not what we promised the people of West Virginia. We're going to stand by our promise. The people of West Virginia have a right to expect us to do that. And that's what we plan to do. Now, it's not going to be easy, but let's put it this way. We're not talking about cuts in that sense, because what we have done year after year after year after year is we have started with every agency assuming they're going to get what they got the year before. And so when you don't give them and you don't grow government, somehow that's characterized as a cut. What we're talking about is drawing the line and sustaining the level of government that we have currently. And there are some areas where there'll have to be reductions in order to do that, but we are talking about containing the growth of government with this budget, and we think that's the direction we need to go. So we're willing to do that, to make those tough decisions. We hope the governor will be willing to do that, to stand by the commitment that he made to the people of West Virginia, because we made this commitment and we're standing by it today. So with that, we will talk more about the details as we go through this conference, but I want to recognize the majority leader. I don't know if you want to Mitch talk to you.
Well, we thank you for the opportunity to present to you this aggressive, bold, monumental, really, agenda for progress in West Virginia, a moment in history in which the people that have been forgotten throughout the hills and valleys, the taxpayer of West Virginia, are now heard. And we look forward to working with the governor in a collegial manner to bring forth this budget that does listen to the people of West Virginia, those who have not been heard for so long that they just continually reaching into their pockets, the poorest people in America, and digging out $300 million. That is a shocking amount of money to take from what is statistically the poorest people in America. So this will put West Virginia on the path to once and for all solve this budget process and this crisis. I want to thank all my Senate and House colleagues for being here and being willing to take the tough stands and make the responsible decisions that aren't always easy, but it's what leadership requires, and we're happy to be in this moment in time to provide the budget and the priorities that West Virginians want, need, and deserve to finally break this cycle of poverty and dependence on government and move our state in a new right direction. Thank you, and we're happy to take any questions.
Will you support any of the governor's tax increase proposals?
In the context of tax reform, in the abstract and in the individual elements of tax increases, solely tax increases, we have very little, if any, interest in supporting just a simple tax increase to backfill government. Your thoughts?
No, I think that's exactly right. I mean, we do think that this does give us an opportunity. The Senate has come forward with the tax reform plan. The House is working on one as well. We've been in communication with one another about the components of that, and we're very interested in continuing down that path of looking toward long-term tax reform that will ensure that we don't get back into the same situation that we're in this year and have been in the past couple of years. But as far as increasing taxes just to continue the growth of government, no. We are not interested in doing that.
Are you going to do it by sunsetting tax exemptions then?
That has been part of the discussion in the overall broad-based tax reform. And I think there's a great deal of interest in tax reform within the legislature. But again, we're still working through the details of that.
So you've got about ballpark $300 million to cut. What, in very broad terms, what has to be cut to get to the $400 million?
We have the various, I don't have them here in front of me, but in general, what has been off the table for so long around here is the programs that are, sacrosanct. DHHR, higher ed, public ed. Those are elements that we recognize that we will have to take looks at. We will have to take a hard look at, and we're willing to do those things. Because the people of West Virginia can no longer prop up this government with increased taxes. We just cannot do it any longer. Now, in the context of broad-based tax reform, we're willing to consider, as the speaker talked about, other mechanisms. But at the end of the day, I think finally, Phil, what you have before you is a group of legislators that are willing to make the tough decisions and go into the accounts and the areas that have for too long been off limits.
So. We will be sharing with you some of the specific areas, but for example, the governor's proposed $105 million that I know he's scaled back already, $35 million is not something that's included in our budget. We are looking at continuing the 2% reductions made by Governor Tomlin in the past budget, the smoothing of our teachers' retirement system that's already been discussed, ending the casino modernization subsidies, ending the Greyhound subsidies. There are a number of different areas that we'll go into, some reduction in the tourism funding. But the bottom line is, as Senator Carmichael has said, we have talked about these three areas and have avoided ever getting into the three big areas that actually constitute roughly three quarters of the general revenue budget, and that is DHHR, higher ed, and K-12 education. We believe there are very responsible ways that we can go into those funds and make reductions. And in addition to that, we think that the amount that we would have to reduce those particular areas can be reduced by some of the reforms that the work groups that have been working in the finance committees, both on the House and the Senate side, have come forward with, can actually reduce the amount that we would have to go into any of those particular areas.
Mr. Speaker, Mr. President, can you talk specifically about some of the cuts in education, whether they be schools, whether they be staffing? It's easy to say we're going to cut education, DHHR. such, but where are you going to make those cuts, and will they affect services in DHHR?
Well, certainly any cut that you make affects, you know, the delivery of services. We think we can find efficiencies in those areas that are the most compassionate, reasonable, responsible manner in which to deliver those reductions that I'm hesitant to even call reductions, because we're spending every penny that the taxpayers of West Virginia have given us with a 4.055 budget without raising taxes. And you know, Kenny, I'll give Phil props for this, Phil Kabler, because he has written over and over that people talk about cuts in the abstract and are unwilling to go into the areas that are necessary in order to deliver those to the responsible balanced budget. And so you have before you here today a group of people who are willing to make the overture into those accounts to make the effort to deliver more efficient services and to just live within our means. So yes, there will be an effect in any account that we make reductions on, but we are doing it in the most responsible manner possible, and we want to announce to you today that we are willing and able to go to those areas that have for so long been off limits.
Does that include job cuts too, as well as budget cuts to those agencies?
I'm sorry, I didn't.
Does that include job cuts? Will positions be eliminated if you're going to cut from DHHR and education? Mm-hmm.
Well, listen, we're not from the podium and making those cuts. We're not in telling people they have to, you know, telling an agency to get rid of someone. We're saying this is the method, this is the amount of money you have to live within. If you have vacancies in your agencies, if you have other areas for efficiencies, then find those areas. But what we're saying as a legislature, we can't do this surgically like an executive branch group can. We have to do this in a manner that allocates the funds, and what I would say, what is so important to this process is we are providing flexibility to the different agencies to be able to implement the spending that we're providing them in the most efficient manner possible, so that we give them flexibility to use those funds in the most efficient manner possible. We've talked about that, and we're already marching through the process, bills that deliver that flexibility, so that the funds that we allocate to them can be used in the most effective, efficient, responsible manner to provide those necessary services to the people of West Virginia that we all want.
Let me just build upon something, Kenny, I think you asked about, specifically about education. When you're talking about, you know, roughly 50 to 60 million total in education reductions, and that is assuming that we can't make up some of that area in some of these other areas that the committees are looking at, which I believe we can, so I think it'll actually be less than that. But the committee has already been looking at up between $10 and $15 million in reductions, simply because of what we've been talking about time and time again, the top-heavy bureaucracy of our education system that goes into the areas of like the education performance audits, RESAs, different areas like that, that are not talking about getting right into the classroom. We're talking about the state level bureaucracy, and we're going to start there in terms of these reductions. And then as you go into the school aid formula, we've been talking with our education committee, our chair and some of the staff of the education committee, to look at ways where we can go into particular steps of that formula that we can actually not necessarily going into the school, the classroom and the teacher positions, but other areas that we can make reductions. So we're going to continue that work over the next 30 days, or the remaining 27 days, and we are going to continue to look at ways that we can reduce that bureaucracy, plus give the flexibility to the school system so that they can move money from one place to another and put that money where it's actually needed and not be restrained in the sense of having to be able to not be able to cut in one area if they have a surplus in another area.
And as we move through the process and the agencies get their allocations of funds, if there are any changes that a particular agency or entity needs to bring to the legislature to say, we have more flexibility, we have better ways of delivering this service, we are more than ready, willing, and able to make those statutory changes to accommodate those flexibility needs that each agency needs and deserves. Brad.
You spoke with the governor this morning. What level of detail did you provide?
James, was I wouldn't say. Listen, we had a good week. I continue, and I think the speaker also continues to keep a cordial relationship with the governor. We are anxious to work with him. We are in no way degenerating into the name-calling aspects of this or that or whatever. What we have, what this group of people here have, is an absolute desire to do the right thing. The right thing. These are not easy decisions. And this has needed to be done for so long in West Virginia. And the governor, I believe, wants to do the right thing as well. He may have a different view of how you get there, and obviously he does. He wants to impose the largest tax increase in state history and spend more in a general revenue budget than ever been spent. So we are willing and able to work with the governor in the most professional manner possible. And we will continue to take the high road. And that's all we can. All we can control is the behavior that we can control.
Mr. Speaker, Mr. President, whoever wants to answer this question, I guess, you're talking about returning to a level of spending that the state had in the previous fiscal year, but there are areas of growth within a budget that you can't control, and I'm specifically talking about Medicaid, but I'm sure there are other areas. How do you account for that growth in your upcoming budget if you're not willing to spend more than what we had in the previous year?
I think we touched on it, Ashton, a few moments ago when we talked about the fact that there will need to be some reductions in sort of the areas that have not been on the table in the past. But in fact, when you talk about reductions, it's actually we're giving them a particular amount to spend. And again, it's what every person, every family does in the state of West Virginia. They have to move money around at times to make up a particular bill that was larger than they expected. So they have to move money from one area to another. That's what we are trying to give flexibility to these, that's why we're trying to give this flexibility to these agencies, because yes, there may be areas where they do need to increase spending, but what we're saying is we have $4.055 billion to spend. And so when we do that and we spend that money, we need to set priorities within that budgetary framework, and whatever is required constitutionally, whatever is essential service, an essential service that an agency has a role to provide in our society, then there are other areas that they can make reductions within that budget. So I think what we're looking at is, yes, there will be some areas that we will have to make reductions in terms of, and again, I'm along with the president, I wouldn't call it reductions. I think it's setting priorities within the current fiscal year budget, because it truly budgeting should be a series of setting priorities. Not saying, well, if I don't spend the exact amount I spent last year, that's a cut. No, spending should be, this is what I have to spend, and this is what I'm going to prioritize to spend within each of these agencies. And I think that's going to be, as we said, require some tough decisions, not only on the part of the legislature, but on the part of these agencies. But it has to be done.
Let me just say also, we talk about spending what we have as that's a novel concept. And it's not. This is the very basic premise. And it's interesting that we have this many people gathered to announce that we're going to spend no more than we have. I mean, you think about that. And so here we are, we're living within our means, and it's news. And that's the essence of this story. And you think about it, put it in a perspective of the last several years. We raised, Chairman Hall, Chairman Nelson, the state earned $4 billion last year in general revenue, roughly, right? Spent $4.2 billion. That's been going on for the past several years. We can't continue down that path. We have to live within our means. And so to simply come to a legislative session and say, we spent $4.2 billion last year. We only raised $4 billion. So now we're going to spend $4.5 billion? I mean, that just makes no sense. And so that's the essence of this announcement today, is that we are finally going to break that cycle and live within the means that we have been given. And we want to fundamentally overhaul the economy and move us in the right direction so that we don't come back to this process every year. But from now, or at least for our tenure, we're going to live within our means.
I could just add one last thing to that, too, and that's this. Every one of these dollars that we're talking about, whether it's increasing this budget by $450 million, every one of those dollars comes out of people's pockets in the pockets of small businesses. And if we're truly looking at economic growth, we have a philosophical difference as to what will create economic growth. This budget creates economic growth. If we are able to stay with 4.055, not spend beyond our means, and let that money stay in the economy within the pockets of the people who spend it on homes, on clothes, on food, and it stays in the pockets of these small businesses that are struggling to make ends meet now, but would like to be able to expand, would like to be able to hire new people. That's economic growth. Expanding the size of government is not economic growth. And I don't know of an economist that's going to tell you it is. So I think that should be front and center, in addition to simply doing the novel thing of doing what all families are doing and living within our means. This is the way and truly the path, I believe, to economic growth in our state.
Mr. Speaker, Mr. President, going back to something Senator Carmichael said, we spent $4.2 billion last year on revenue of $4 billion. Why did we not take steps last year to do this? What's different between this year and last year? The Republican majorities in the House and Senate last year, and you had a Democratic governor.
I think if you recall, the governor had proposed to spend a great deal more than what we spent last year. And we did hold the line. Now, we did increase some spending, and you're right. But we held the line, and I think we got some criticism for it, obviously, of holding the line, because had Governor, you know, with all due respect to Governor Tomlin, had he had his proposal enacted into law, we would have been spending more than what we're spending right now, and the hole would have been deeper that we had to fill in the current fiscal year budget. We did hold the line to a large degree on tax increases and additional spending last year. But I think we're certainly building upon that this year, and we're going to hold the line on spending this year.
The other element, Kenny, is that we're within hours of passing a budget, and the revenue estimate was changed by $90 million from the governor's office. So that's an impact that certainly had an effect. So that's just another element.
So I just want to be clear in summary here.
By the way, we're getting better at this, too. That's accurate.
Well, let me say this. I mean, I think what we can say is that those reductions will be within those areas, but not necessarily all of those areas or any particular, you know, if we're able to come up with, as these work groups go through this process that they're going through and they're completing now, they have found a number of areas that they believe that we can make reductions in other areas, and that money would come off of what we would have to reduce the amount in those areas. So it's not necessarily accurate to say that each of those areas is going to have a particular cut. What it is accurate to say is that once we have gone through those very specific areas, we are going to have to go into the universe of those particular, the area that's basically three quarters of our budget in order to balance this budget.
And furthermore, as has been done many times, is that we can always come back with supplemental appropriations for those areas that we absolutely we have additional money, perhaps, and we're able to supplement those budgets. So,
Senator, this press release quotes you as saying that you're going to have a budget passed by day 60. How is that possible? How do you do that? I mean, I think there's been pressure from the governor's office. Why haven't we seen a budget plan thus far? And the response has always been there are bills that are passed throughout the session that have a financial impact. So does that mean we get all the other bills done by day 59 and a budget bill on day 60?
Yes, we are committed to passing a budget before the end of the session, which has not been done for many years.
Is that to anticipate there may be a negative response on the other end, or is it just a matter of...
Well, we're committed to passing a budget, and if there's a negative response on the other end, then that's, you know, we'll deal with that. But to honor our commitment to the people of West Virginia, we will pass that budget. Yes. Mike,
we can have it when we have all the legislation passed that would affect it. So all you have to do is make sure that you don't wait till late Saturday night to pass a bill that affects it. Legislative management would say that House and Senate bills, which we work Saturday in the Senate, I mean, can be done in time so that we can construct the document and have it on people's desks. I can tell you this, if all those bills were passed today, I could have that budget bill out there Monday.
Yeah, the actual construction of the budget bill itself is, the big part is agreeing upon the framework, which is what we're doing here today. We're putting forth the framework. The actual construction of the line items within the budget is a process of a day and a half, 2 days.
Yeah. On day 55.
Right. We got that.
And
so.
And if we know what those things are going to be, then we can do the budget even sooner.
Yeah.
Mr. President, Mr.
Yes.
Speaker, will you be setting that deadline with your delegates, with your senators? We're going to pass this by X, and that's it?
We've already in the House talked about the pieces of legislation that we think are necessary. And we've been working with our chairs, which we meet periodically throughout the week and talked about. And so we've identified a number of these pieces of legislation that are already running. In fact, we've already a higher education reform bill that will allow the flexibility to be able to make some of these changes in higher ed has already been passed through the House. So a number of these pieces of legislation are already have passed one or the other houses of the legislature as we stand here today. But let me also just point out, I mean, we know the governor has had a press conference, but we don't have modified legislation up from him yet on a number of these things that he has changed from the original state of the state legislation. And the day today is tomorrow will be the deadline for introducing bills in the House. So those will just have to be modifications to pieces of legislation that he's put up early in the session. But you know, he had a press conference to discuss this, but we have not seen that legislation yet from him on the second group of legislation.
What would the deadline be for the House?
Deadline decision? For?
To pass bills which are financially related, which relate to the budget.
Well, I think, you know, we have crossover day anyway, which is day 50, so no bill can be passed beyond that anyway without suspending the rules. It has to pass this House of Origin by that time. So that would, even at that point, would give the time to do the budget, but we're going to work toward doing it even earlier than that.
Right. This is not like a gotcha moment. We're saying we are going to pass a budget before day 60. That's the message. And it's a budget that will be responsible and provides jobs and opportunity for the citizens and lives within our means. That's the message.
Mr. President, if the Senate should adopt the Tax Reform Committee's proposal, which is taking the sales tax from 6% to a general consumption tax of 8%, or even if you don't do that, but just remove some of the current sales tax exemptions, how's that not a tax increase? Because people are going to be paying taxes on stuff they weren't paying taxes on before.
If I told you that we were going to increase one tax by $5 and decrease another tax by $5, would that be a tax increase?
Not on net, no.
Right, and that's the concept with this. This is a revenue neutral mechanism to generate jobs and opportunity that shifts to a tax structure that incentivizes growth and jobs that many economists recognize as a pro-growth, pro-jobs agenda. And other states are utilizing to great success and growing exponentially faster than West Virginia. So I don't mean to play a bit, but it's the essence of it is a revenue neutral stream that may be phased in to ensure that we do it in a proper manner and don't leave ourselves short. But it is very important that we recognize it's a fundamental overhaul of the tax system in West Virginia that has been desperately needed for many years.
Business taxes by almost $300 million a year and didn't seem to generate any noticeable growth in the economy.
Yeah.
What happened with the corporate net business franchise?
It's a great question. I hear it all the time, and you're asking us to disprove a negative, in essence, by saying what would the job community and the prospects in West Virginia have looked like had that Democrat-led legislature not passed those bills that reduce the corporate net and so forth. So it's difficult to say. How do you say what the state would have looked like had that not passed? I think it's not appropriate to simply say whatever tax that was generating would still be here in the midst of the recession and so forth. And so What we rely upon are the economic projections that the most renowned economists and those who have studied the issues determine to be the pro-growth, pro-job structure of a tax system. And so I think it'd be hard to answer that question. I think it's frankly hard to ask that question also, because you're trying to disprove a negative that it's basically impossible to speculate upon in the midst of other criteria and so forth.
I mean, if I could just add to that, I mean, I don't think there's anyone in this room, legislators or otherwise, that would not say that the greatest impact on our economy over the last 8 years has been in the energy sector and severance tax and the ripple effect from that. And that is, in my opinion, to a large degree, a separate issue from what has taken place in terms of the tax reductions that we did, which I think in the long term will, in fact, and I don't really accept your premise that it hasn't had a positive impact. I think it has had a positive impact, and I think it has helped to some degree to cushion what we felt in our economy because of the downturn in the energy industry, because of the war on coal, because of these issues that have really, you know, clearly had a devastating impact on our overall economy. The other thing I would say is this: you said it's hard to speculate. One thing I will speculate on: had we had that money in our budget, we would have been spending that money, and now the hole that we would be trying to get out of would be $200 or $300 million more than it is right now. I'm confident of that, and I think that the idea that somehow those tax reductions did not help is false. I do think they have helped. I think they have helped businesses who have had to weather this storm be able to weather it a little better than they would have otherwise. And I think in the long term, you will see additional positive effect from those reductions.
Mr. President, Mr. Speaker, there is a school of thought that says government knows no bounds, government knows no limits, and that inflation has to be built into each budget. What would you tell people who subscribe to those theories?
Today's a new day. Thank you. This is a day in which this legislature is leading the charge on restraining and controlling the growth of government and delivering for the people of West Virginia the responsible, dramatic budget that is called upon to live within our means. I think that concludes what we have in terms of presentation material. We're happy to stay and answer some other questions, various members and so forth. Thank you for this opportunity, and I think it's a great day for the citizens of West Virginia that on the 34th day, this legislature has brought forth a framework for a budget that lives within our means. Thank you very much.